let's pick back up where we left off. In the last video, we were looking at the ambiguous case of the law of science. Now what we're going to do is we're going to kind of look at some applications, but also we're going to look at how you can use the sign to help you find the height of a triangle, not necessarily a right triangle, and then be able to find the area of that triangle. And the area of the triangle, of course, we know is 1/2 times base times height. If I use this drawing here, and the way I've got it drawn, this kind of looks like my base because I've drawn my height to it. So my base would be C, but what's the height? Well, that's where I use the trig function. I have a right triangle here, and I can say that the sine of A, angle A, is equal to the height divided by this side here, B. I could also work on this side as well, and as you'll see, there's more than one option here. But I've got that the sine of A is equal to the height divided by B, multiply both sides by B, I have the height is B times the sine of A. So if I plug that in and multiply this out, I get 1/2 BC sine A. Now notice here, B and C are two sides, A is the included angle. So this works when you have the side angle side set up. And it doesn't matter if it has to be, it doesn't have to be B and C and angle A. As it turns out, you can find the area of a triangle, 1/2 BC sine A, 1/2 AC sine B, 1/2 AB sine C. Just remember, it's 1/2 times one side times the another side times the sine of the included angle, you'll be golden. Also, if you look at this extended equation here, if I was to divide through by all three parts here, by 1/2 ABC, if I was to divide through this by 1/2 ABC, look what I'm going to have happen here. The halves are going to cancel, the b's are going to cancel, the c's are going to cancel. I get the sine of a over a. Here the halves are going to cancel, the a's are going to cancel, the c's are going to cancel. I get the sine of b over b. The halves are going to cancel, the a's are going to cancel, the b's are going to cancel. I get the sine of c over c. I have, from this, the law of sines. Now let's actually try to find an area of a triangle here. Since a triangle has sides of lengths 12 meters and 6 meters, and the angle between them, it has to be the included angle, is 76 degrees. Find the area of the triangle. Well, we're going to plug it right into here. I'm going to have the area equal to 1/2 times one side times another side times the sine of the included angle. Now, I forgot my calculator with me here, and I didn't want to go back and get it. So, fortunately, I had worked this problem out in advance, and when I multiplied this all out to the nearest one decimal place, to the nearest tenth, I got this to be 34.9. Now remember, this was in meters, so my area is in square meters to the nearest tenth. Easy peasy. All right. Now the next two problems are examples of where we can use the law of science to help us solve a story problem-oriented kind of a deal. And in both cases, I think, I'm sorry, it's so sloppy here. In both cases, I am going to draw a diagram to help me kind of get a good idea of what's going on. So it says to measure the maximum height of a water fountain, a trig student measures the angle of elevation of the maximum point to be 25 degrees. Then at a point 30 feet farther away along the same line of sight, the angle of elevation is down to 18 degrees. If the eye level of the student is 5.5 feet, find the maximum height of the water. So, here's the ground, and here's the water fountain. Do I have a blue pen? Gotta make it look like water. I have a blue pen. Here we go. So, here's the water fountain. Okay, and we have a trig student that has an eye level at 5.5 feet. So, what I'm going to do is I'm going to try to do that with a dotted line here, but I still have right angles no matter what. And I'm going to have this to be 5.5 feet. I don't know if you can see that very well on the screen. I wrote that kind of small. But that's going to be his eye level. Now he's looking at this and he discovers that he is looking at the angle of elevation to the maximum point up here is 25 degrees. So let's see if I can, maybe I better draw this with a... Okay, to the maximum height there. Oop. And this is 25 degrees. Now, if he goes back, it looks like 30 feet further back, let's say all the way back to here, this is not drawn to scale, so that this distance here would be 30 feet. Then I'm going to probably have to use my yardstick this time. And I draw this in. I have an angle of elevation that dropped down to 18 degrees. That's this angle right here, 18 degrees. Now, I am trying to find the maximum height of a water, so clearly I'm going to have to remember to add the 5.5 feet to whatever this turns out to be. And that will be my goal first, is to find from this mark where I have my right triangles to here. So whatever this distance is, which I'm going to call h, I'm going to have to add 5.5 to it, because this I levels is at 5.5 feet. All right, now what I need to do here is I need to go about to set up some type of right triangle where maybe I can use Sokotoa or something like that, or perhaps I can use maybe the law of sines. But I'm looking and I really only have this measure right here. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to call this distance from here to here, I'll call it x. Here, I'll put x right here. And so that means I can set up two equations using, see, I have the adjacent and I'm looking for the opposite. I'm taking tangent. I can write that the tangent of 25 degrees is equal to h over x, which tells me that h then is equal to x times the tangent of 25 degrees. I can also, using this angle, I can say that the tangent of 18 degrees is equal to h over this side, which would be x plus 30. Well, I have a system of equations. I am going to substitute x tan 25, this part right here, I'm going to plug that in for h, and I get the tangent of 18 is equal to x tan 25 degrees over x plus 30. Now, it's a little bit of a pain, but what you're going to do is you're going to solve for x. So I will probably multiply both sides by x plus 30, or think of it as cross multiplying. I would have x plus 30 times the tangent of 18 degrees, I'm getting lazy about putting my degree sign in there, is equal to x times the tangent of 25 degrees. I'm going to distribute. I have x tangent of 18 degrees plus 30 times the tangent of 18 degrees is equal to x times the tangent of 25 degrees. So I just distributed. I'm solving for x. I have to get my variable on one side. I'm going to subtract, and this is kind of cheap to write it this way, but I'm going to subtract x times the tangent of 18 degrees. Okay, so these are going to cancel. I'm going to get 30 tangent, oh, I left myself enough space here, is equal to, now, they have a common factor of x, so I'm going to factor that x out, and I'm going to write this as the tangent of 25 degrees minus the tangent of 18 degrees. By the way, that is not the tangent of 7 degrees. Now I'm going to divide both sides by this crazy looking expression here. Now remember, I'm trying to find a height, but I'm doing all this work just to find x. I'll plug back into here in just a second. At least I hope I will. And all this cancels out. And again, I did not bring my calculator with me, which was really silly. But when I did all this work, I got this to be 68.9422. 68.9422. Now remember, we're going to round to the nearest tenth of a foot, but before I, because I'm looking for the height, I'm going to leave this messy like this with four decimal places. So I don't want to do intermediate rounding and then lose accuracy. So that's 68.9422. And now I'm going to plug this in here to find the actual h, which would be 68.9422 times the tangent of 25 degrees. Again, I need my calculator, but I didn't bring my calculator, so when I did all this work, I got 32.14. All right, so 32.14. Now I'm going to round to the nearest tenth. So, and this is actually goes on. I'm going to get h is equal to approximately 32.1. Now, I'm not done, but I'm really, really close, because that's the height right here, looks like a little bit more than 32 feet. This is in feet. But I can't forget the eyesight, the eye level of the students, so I'm going to add 5.5, and I get 37.6, and this is going to be in feet here. So now all I have to do is write out my answer, except I didn't have enough forethought to leave very much space here. So it says to find the maximum height of the water, the maximum height of the water is 37.6 feet. Now again, it's a story problem. Write your answer out, short sentence, doesn't have to be extravagant, but make sure that you put your units in there and make sure that you've answered the question. All right, one more to go here. It says an 80-foot flagpole is located at the top of a hill. An observer 220 feet down the hill measures the angle formed by the bottom of the pole to the top of the pole to be 17.7 degrees. I'm definitely drawing a picture of this. Determine the angle of inclination of the hill to the nearest tenth of a degree. Definitely got to draw a picture. So let's say this is level ground, and we have a hill, and then at the top of this hill, let's draw this halfway decent, we're going to draw it, to the top of the hill, we have a flagpole. Okay, interesting place to put a flagpole. Okay, and it's a flagpole, so let's put a flag there. Okay, now, it's an 80-foot flagpole. It's at the top of the hill. An observer 220 feet down the hill, so down the hill, this is 220 feet. He looks from here, he looks from the bottom, and then he looks to the top. Oh, yeah. Now, I don't do the greatest job drawing these figures out, but I do well enough so that I don't get confused by making it so messy and so little that I can't tell what's what. So make sure that your drawing's halfway reasonable here. This angle right here turns out to be 17.7 degrees. You are to determine the angle of inclination of the hill to the nearest tenth of a degree. Well, that would be this angle right here. You're trying to find this. Let's call it theta. So you're going to attempt to solve this by finding theta here. Let's see what we have. We have... Well, we have a little bit here. Let's see. I think I can do... Let's see. Well, you know what? I think what I'm going to do is I'm going to attempt to find this angle. The reason I'm going to attempt to find this angle is because I know this is 90. If I can find this, then I can find this and subtract the 17.7 from the whole thing to figure out what theta is. Let me call this alpha. So the reason I do that is because I noticed that I had this angle on the opposite side, this angle on the opposite side. I'm going to use the law of sines. I'm not even messing with this bottom triangle down here. I'm going to write that the sine of 17.7 degrees is to 80. Remember, I'm looking at this triangle, this little skinnier one up here, is to the sine of alpha, whatever that is, to 220. So I cross-multiply, I have 80 times the sine of alpha is equal to 220 times the sine of 17.7 degrees. Yeah, this will work. This should work. Divide both sides by 80. And I have the sine of alpha equals to, and again, I want to make sure that I have the right number, so I grab my calculator, 0.8361, if I'm not mistaken. So now to find alpha, I'm going to take the inverse sine of 0.8361. I'm going to get alpha to be 56.7. 56.7, that's this guy up here. 56.7 degrees. Well, if this is 56.7, this is 90, I need this angle here, which would be its complement. 90 minus 56.7 would be what, 33.3? That's kind of cool. 33.3 degrees. But that's the whole angle here. Now I have to subtract 17.7 from that and line up those decimal points. C5, looks like I get 15.6. That this angle right here is 15.6 degrees. So determine the angle of inclination of the hill. The angle of inclination of the hill is 15.6 degrees, and that of course is to the nearest tenth. Alright, so there shows you a couple of examples of what you can do with this, and according, also don't forget about this area formula. This guy comes in handier than you might think. Alright, and then make sure that you remember which situations use the law of sines. That's for angle-angle-side, angle-side-angle, and then of course the ambiguous side-side-angle. What's left is side-side-side and side-angle-side, and we'll be doing that in the next section when we talk about the law of cosines.